And I looked, and behold, a pale horse, and his name that sat upon him was Death, and Hell followed with him, and power was given unto them over the fourth part of the earth, to kill with sword, and with hunger, and with the beasts of the earth. Book of Revelation, chapter 6, verse 8. There have been many related sequential coincidences all throughout my life. Incidents that by themselves would have led nowhere. Statistically, the odds against the same are a related sequence of events happening to one individual are astronomically high. It is this series of incidents that have convinced me that God has had a hand in my life. I do not believe in fate. I do not believe in accidents. I cannot and will not accept the theory that long sequences of unrelated accidents determine world events. It is inconceivable that those with power and wealth would not band together with a common bond, a common interest, and a long-range plan to decide and direct the future of the world. For those with the resources to do otherwise would be totally irresponsible. I know that I would be the first to organize a conspiracy to control the outcome of the future if I were such a person and a conspiracy did not yet exist. I would do it in an attempt to ensure the survival of the principles in which I believe, the survival of my family, my survival, and the survival of the human race, if for no other reason. I believe, therefore, that a grand game of chess is being played on a level that we can barely imagine. And we are the pawns. Pawns are valuable only under certain circumstances and are frequently sacrificed to gain an advantage. Anyone who has studied military strategy is familiar with the concept of sacrifice. Those who have seriously studied history have probably discovered the real reason we go to war on a regularly scheduled basis. My research has shown, at this point, that the future laid out for us may be just about impossible to change. I do not agree with the means by which the powerful few have chosen for us to reach the end. I do not agree that the end is where we should end at all. But unless we can wake the people from their sleep, nothing short of civil war will stop the planned outcome. I base that statement not on defeatism, but on the apathy of the majority of the American people. 25 years ago, I would have believed otherwise. But 25 years ago, I was also sound asleep. We have been taught lies. Reality is not at all what we perceive it to be. We cannot survive any longer by hanging on to the falsehoods of the past. Reality must be discerned at all costs if we are to be a part of the future. Truth must prevail in all instances, no matter who it hurts or helps, if we are to continue to live upon this earth. At this point, what we want may no longer matter. It is what we must do to ensure our survival that counts. The old way is in the certain process of destruction, and a new world order is beating down the door. I fear for the little ones, the innocents, who are already paying for our mistakes. There exists a great army of occupationally orphaned children. They are attending government-controlled daycare centers. There are latchkey kids who are running wild in the street, and the lopsided, emotionally wounded children of single welfare mothers, born only for the sake of more money in the monthly check. Open your eyes and look at them, for they are the future. In them, I see the sure and certain destruction of this once proud nation. Their vacant eyes, I see the death of freedom. They carry with them a great emptiness, and someone will surely pay a great price for their suffering. If we do not act in concert with each other and ensure that the future becomes what we need it to be, then we will surely deserve whatever fate awaits us. I believe with all my heart that God put me in places and in positions throughout my life so that I would be able to deliver this warning to his people. I pray that I have been worthy and that I have done my job. From the time a person leaves its mother's womb, its every effort is directed toward building, maintaining, and withdrawing into artificial wombs various sorts of substitute protective devices or shells. The objective of these artificial wombs is to provide a stable environment for both stable and unstable activity, to provide a shelter for the evolutionary processes of growth and maturity, in effect, survival, to provide security for freedom, and to provide defensive protection for offensive activity. This is equally true of both the general public and the elite. However, there is a definite difference in the way each of these classes go about the solution of problems. The primary reason why the individual citizens of a country create a political structure is a subconscious wish or desire to perpetuate their own dependency relationship of child. Simply put, they want a human god to eliminate all risk from their life, pat them on the head, kiss their bruises, put a chicken on every dinner table, clothe their bodies, tuck them into bed at night, and tell them that everything will be all right when they wake up in the morning. This public demand is incredible. So the human god, the politician, meets incredibility with incredibility by promising the world and delivering nothing. So who is the bigger liar, the public or the godfather? This public behavior is surrender born of fear, laziness, and expediency. It is the basis of the welfare state as a strategic weapon, useful against a disgusting public. Most people want to be able to subdue and or kill other human beings which disturb their daily lives. But they do not want to have to cope with the moral and religious issues which such an overt act on their part might raise. Therefore, they assign the dirty work to others, including their own children, so as to keep the blood off their own hands. They rave about the humane treatment of animals, and then sit down to a delicious hamburger from a whitewashed slaughterhouse down the street and out of sight. But even more hypocritical, they pay taxes to finance a professional association of hitmen, collectively called politicians, and then complain about corruption in government. Again, most people want to be free to do things, but they are afraid to fail. A fear of failure is manifested in irresponsibility, and especially in delegating those personal responsibilities to others where success is uncertain or carries possible or created liabilities which the person is not prepared to accept. They want authority, but they will not accept responsibility or liability. So they hire politicians to face reality for them. The people hire the politicians so that the people can, 1, obtain security without managing it, 2, obtain action without thinking about it, 3, inflict theft, injury, and death upon others without having to contemplate either life or death, or avoid responsibility for their own intentions. 5, obtain the benefits of reality and science without exerting themselves in the discipline of facing or learning either of these things. They give the politicians the power to create and manage a war machine to, 1, provide for the survival of the nation womb, 2, prevent encroachment of anything upon the nation womb, 3, destroy the enemy who threatens the nation womb, 4, destroy those citizens of their own country who do not conform for the sake of stability of the nation womb. Politicians hold many quasi-military jobs, the lowest being the police, which are soldiers, the attorneys and the CPAs next, who are spies and saboteurs, and the judges who shout the orders and run the closed union military shop for whatever the market will bear. The generals are industrialists. The presidential level of commander-in-chief is shared by the international bankers. The people know that they have created this farce and financed it with their own taxes, but they would rather knuckle under than be the hypocrite. Thus, a nation becomes divided into two very distinct parts, a docile subnation and a political subnation. The political subnation remains attached to the docile subnation, tolerates it, and leeches its substance until it grows strong enough to detach itself and then devour its parent. Human beings are machines, levers which may be grasped and turned, and there is little real difference between automating a society and automating a shoe factory. Factor 1. As in every social system approach, stability is achieved only by understanding and accounting for human nature. A failure to do so can be, and usually is, disastrous. As in other human social schemes, one form or another of intimidation or incentive is essential to the success of the draft. Physical principles of action and reaction must be applied to both internal and external subsystems. To secure the draft, individual brainwashing, programming, and both the family unit and the peer group must be engaged and brought under control. Factor 2. The man of the household must be housebroken to ensure that Junior will grow up with the right social training and attitudes. The advertising media, etc., are engaged to see to it that father-to-be is compliant before or by the time he is married. He is taught that he either conforms to the social notch cut out for him, or his sex life will be hobbled, and his tender companionship will be zero. He is made to see that women demand security more than logical, principled, or honorable behavior. By the time his son must go to war, father, with jelly for a backbone, will slam a gun into Junior's hand before father will risk the censure of his peers or make a hypocrite of himself by crossing the investment he has in his own personal opinion or self-esteem. Junior will go to war. Our father will be embarrassed. So Junior will go to war, the true purpose notwithstanding. Factor 3. The female element of human society is ruled by emotion first and logic second. In the battle between logic and imagination, imagination always wins. Fantasy prevails. Maternal instinct dominates, so that the child comes first and the future comes second. A woman with a newborn baby is too starry-eyed to see a wealthy man's cannon fodder or a cheap source of slave labor. A woman must, however, be conditioned to accept the transition to reality when it comes or sooner. As the transition becomes more difficult to manage, the family unit must be carefully disintegrated, and state-controlled public education and state-operated child care centers must become more common and legally enforced so as to begin the detachment of the child from the mother and father at an earlier age. Inoculation of behavioral drugs can speed the transition for the child. Factor 4. Junior. The emotional pressure for self-preservation during the time of war and the self-serving attitude of the common herd that have an option to avoid the battlefield is all of the pressure finally necessary to propel Johnny off to war. Their quiet blackmailings of him are the threats: no sacrifice, no friends, no glory, no girlfriend. Factor 5. Sister. And what about Junior's sister? She is given all the good things of life by her father and taught to expect the same from her future husband regardless of the price. Factor 6. Those who will not use their brains are no better off than those who have no brains. And so this mindless school of jellyfish, father, mother, son, and daughter, become useful beasts of burden or trainers of the same. So now you know. You can see every step that the elite have taken in their war to control this once great nation. You can see the steps that will be taken in the future. You can no longer pretend innocence. Your denial of the conspiracy will fall on deaf ears. This tape is part of the education that will give Americans the weapons needed in the coming months and years of hardship as the New World Order struggles to be born. Truths cannot be negated or shrugged away. The message is this: you must accept that you have been cattle, and the ultimate consequence of being cattle, which is slavery, or you must prepare to fight, and if necessary, die to preserve your God-given right to freedom. History is replete with whispers of secret societies, accounts of elders or priests who guarded the forbidden knowledge of ancient people, prominent men meeting in secret who directed the course of civilization are recorded in the writings of all people. The oldest is the Brotherhood of the Snake, also called the Brotherhood of the Dragon, and it still exists under many different names. The Brotherhood of the Snake is devoted to guarding the secrets of the ages and to the recognition of Lucifer as the one and only true God. If you do not believe in God, Lucifer, or Satan, you must understand that there are great masses of people who do. I do not believe in racism, but millions do, and their beliefs and actions based upon those beliefs will affect me. It is clear that religion has always played a significant role in the course of these organizations. Communication with a higher source often divine, is a familiar claim in all but a few. The secrets of these groups are thought to be so profound that only a chosen, well-educated few are able to understand and use them. These men use their special knowledge for the benefit of all mankind. At least, that is what they claim. But how are we to know, since their knowledge and actions have been secret? Fortunately, some of it has become public knowledge. Secret societies mirror many facets of ordinary life. There is always an exclusivity of membership, with the resultant importance attached to being or becoming a member. This is found in all human endeavors, even those which are not secret, such as football teams or country clubs. This exclusivity of membership is actually one of the secret society's most powerful weapons. There is the use of signs, passwords, and other tools. These have always performed valuable functions in man's organizations everywhere. The stated reason, almost always different from the real reason for the society's existence, is important. It can be anything, but is usually fraternal, and is found in all pressure groups wherever people congregate. The most potent tool of any secret society is the ritual and myth surrounding initiation. These special binding ceremonies have very deep meaning for the participants. Initiation performs several functions which make up the heart and soul of any true secret society. Like boot camp, the initiation into the armed forces, important aspects of human thought that are universally compelling are merged to train and maintain the efforts of a group of people to operate in a certain direction. Initiation bonds the members together in mysticism. Neophytes gain knowledge of a secret, giving them special status. The ancient meaning of neophyte is planted anew, or reborn. A higher initiation is, in reality, a promotion inspiring loyalty and the desire to move up to the next rung. The goals of the society are reinforced, causing the initiated to act toward those goals in everyday life. That brings about a change in the political and social action of the member. The change is always in the best interest of the goals of the leaders of the secret society. The leaders are called adepts. This can best be illustrated by the soldier trained to follow orders without thinking. The result is often the wounding or death of the soldier for the realization of the commander's goal, which may or may not be good for the overall community. Initiation is a means of rewarding ambitious men who can be trusted. You'll notice that the higher the degree of initiation, the fewer the members who possess the degree. This is not because the other members are not ambitious, but because a process of very careful selection is being conducted. A point is reached where no effort is good enough without a pull up by the higher members. Most members never proceed beyond this point and never learn the real secret purpose of the group. The frozen member from that point on serves only as a part of the political power base, as indeed he has always done. You may have guessed by now that initiation is a way to determine who can and cannot be trusted. A method of deciding exactly who is to become an adept may be decided during initiation by asking the candidate to spit upon the Christian cross. If the candidate refuses, the members congratulate him and tell him, "You have made the right choice, as a true adept would never do such a terrible thing." The newly initiated might find it disconcerting, however, that he or she never advances any higher. If instead the candidate spits upon the cross, he or she has demonstrated a knowledge of one of the mysteries and soon will find him or herself a candidate for the next higher level. The mystery is that religion is but a tool to control the masses. Knowledge or wisdom is their only God, through which man himself will become God. Man's desire to be one of the elect is something that no power on earth has been able to lessen, let alone destroy. It is one of the secrets of secret society. It is what gives them a political base and lots of clout. Members often vote the same, and give each other preference in daily business, legal, and social activity. It is the deepest desire of many to be able to say, I belong to the elect. The first secret that one must know to even begin to understand the mysteries is that their members believe that there are but few truly mature minds in the world. They believe that those minds belong exclusively to them. The philosophy that follows is the classic secret society view of humanity. When a person of strong intellect is confronted with a problem which calls for the use of reasoning faculties, they keep their poise and attempt to reach a solution by garnering facts bearing upon the question. On the other hand, those who are immature, when confronted by the same problem, are overwhelmed. While the former may be said to be qualified to solve the mystery of their own destiny, the latter must be led like a bunch of animals and taught in the simplest language. Like sheep, they are totally dependent upon the shepherd. The able intellect is taught the mysteries and the esoteric spiritual truths. The masses are taught the literal, exoteric interpretations. While the masses worship the five senses, the select few observe, recognizing in the gulf between them the symbolic concretions of great abstract truth. The elect are given knowledge of the mysteries and are illumined, and are thus known as the Illuminati, or the Illuminated One, the guardians of the secrets of the ages. Three early secret societies that can be directly connected to a modern descendant are the cults of Roshaniya, Mithras, and their counterpart, the Builders. They have many things in common with the Freemasons of today, as well as with many other branches of the Illuminati. For instance, common to the Brotherhood are the symbolic rebirth into a new life without going through the portal of death during initiation, reference to the lion, and the grip of the lion's paw in the Master Mason's degree. The three degrees, which is the same as the ancient Masonic rites before the many other degrees were added, the ladder of seven rungs, men only, and the all-seeing eye. Of special interest is the powerful society in Afghanistan in ancient times called the Roshaniya, Illuminated One. There are actually references to this mystical cult going back through history to the House of Wisdom at Cairo. The major tenets of this cult were the abolition of private property, the elimination of religion, the elimination of nation-states, the belief that illumination emanated from the Supreme Being who desired a class of perfect men and women to carry out the organization and direction of the world, belief in a plan to reshape the social system of the world by first taking control of individual countries one by one, and the belief that after reaching the fourth degree, one could communicate directly with the unknown supervisors who had imparted knowledge to initiates throughout the ages. Wise men will again recognize the Brotherhood. Can you hear the echo of the Nazi Party, the Communist Party, the extreme right, and the extreme left? The important fact to remember is that the leaders of both the right and the left are a small, hardcore of men who have been and still are Illuminists or members of the Brotherhood. They may have been or may be members of the Christian or Jewish religion, but that is only to further their own ends. They are and always have been Luciferian and internationalist. They give allegiance to no particular nation, although they have used, on occasion, nationalism to further their causes. Their only concern is to gain greater economic and political power. The ultimate objective of the leaders of both groups is identical. They are determined to win for themselves undisputed control of the wealth, natural resources, and manpower of the entire planet. They intend to turn the world into their conception of a Luciferian totalitarian socialist state. In the process, they will eliminate all Christians, Jews, and atheists. You have just learned one, but only one, of the great mystery. I hope to show that most modern secret societies, and especially those that practice degrees of initiation, and that is the key, are really one society with one purpose. You may call them whatever you wish. The Order of the Quest, the Jason Society, the Roshaniya, the Kabbalah, the Knights Templar, the Knights of Malta, the Knights of Columbus, the Jesuits, the Masons, the Ancient and Mystical Order of Rosicrucii, the Illuminati, the Nazi Party, the Communist Party, the executive members of the Council on Foreign Relations, the Group, the Brotherhood of the Dragon, the Rosicrucians, the Royal Institute of International Affairs, the Trilateral Commission, the Bilderberg Group, the Open Friendly Secret Society of the Vatican, the Russell Trust, the Skull and Bone, the Scroll and Key, the Order. They are all the same, and all work toward the same ultimate goal, a new world order. Many of them, however, disagree on exactly who will rule this new world order, and that is what causes them to sometimes pull in opposite directions while nevertheless proceeding toward the same goal. The Trilateral Commission is an elite group of some 300 very prominent business, political, and intellectual decision makers of Western Europe, North America, and Japan. This enterprise is a private agency that works to build up political and economic cooperation among the three regions. Its grand design, which it no longer hides, is a new world order. A key to the danger presented by the Trilateral Commission is its seminal piece written for them by Harvard professor Samuel P. Huntington in the mid-70s. In the paper, Professor Huntington recommended that democracy and economic development be discarded as outdated ideas. He wrote the following as co-author of the book Crises in Democracy. We have come to recognize that there are potential desirable limits to economic growth. There are also potentially desirable limits to the indefinite extension of political democracy. A government which lacks authority will have little ability short of cataclysmic crises to impose on its people the sacrifices which may be necessary. Look at the Council on Foreign Relations. Many members, in fact, the majority, never serve on the executive committees. They never go through any initiation of any kind. They are, in fact, the power base and are used to gain a consensus of opinion. The majority are not really members, but are made to feel as if they are. In reality, they are being used and are unwilling or unable to understand. The executive committee is an inner core of intimate associates, members of a secret society called the Order of the Quest, also known as the Jason Society, devoted to a common purpose. The members are an outer circle on whom the inner core acts by personal persuasion, patronage, and social pressure. That is how they bought Henry Kissinger. Rockefeller gave Kissinger a grant of $50,000 in the early 50s, a fortune in those days, and made dear old Henry a member of the CFR. Anyone in the outer circle who does not toe the mark is summarily expelled, and the lesson is not lost on those who remain. Do you remember the human desire to be a member of the elect? That is the principle at work. The Council on Foreign Relations has been the foremost flank of America's foreign policy establishment for more than half a century. The Council on Foreign Relations is a private organization of business executives, scholars, and political leaders that studies global problems and plays a key role in developing United States foreign policy. The CFR is one of the most powerful semi-official groups concerned with America's role in international affairs. It is controlled by an elect group of men recruited from the Skull and Bones and the Scroll and Key societies of Harvard and Yale, which are both chapters of a secret branch of the Illuminati known as Chapter 322 of the Order. The members of the Order make up the Executive Committee of the Council on Foreign Relations after undergoing initiation into the Order of the Quest, also known as the Jason Society. The Council on Foreign Relations is an offshoot sister organization to the British Royal Institute of International Affairs. Their goal is a new world order. Although it existed as a dinner club in New York, it did not take on its present power until 1921, when it merged with the Royal Institute of International Affairs and received its financial base from J.P. Morgan, the Carnegie Endowment, the Rockefeller family, and other Wall Street banking interests. The Council on Foreign Relations controls our government. Through the years, its members have infiltrated the entire executive branch, State Department, Justice Department, Central Intelligence Agency, and the top ranks of the military. Every director of the Central Intelligence Agency has been a member of the CFR. Most presidents since Roosevelt have been members. The members of the CFR dominate ownership of the press, and most, if not all, of America's top journalists are members. The CFR does not conform to government policy. The government conforms to CFR policy. The CFR is a secret society in that it forbids the taking of notes or the publishing of minutes of its meeting. Any member who divulges the subject or any part of any conversation or talk that took place during a meeting is terminated. The goal of the Council on Foreign Relations is a new world order. Remember, never worship a leader. If you worship a leader, you then no longer have the ability to recognize when you have been deceived. The most powerful secret organization in the world is the Bilderberg Group, organized in 1952 and named after the hotel where its first meeting took place in 1954. The man who organized the Bilderberg Group, Prince Bernhard of the Netherlands, has the power to veto the Vatican's choice of any pope it selects. Prince Bernhard has this veto power because his family, the Habsburgs, are descended from the Roman emperors. Prince Bernhard is the leader of the Black Families. He claims descent from the House of David and thus can truly say that he is related to Jesus. Prince Bernhard, with the help of the CIA, brought the hidden ruling body of the Illuminati into public knowledge as the Bilderberg Group. This is the official alliance that makes up the world governing body. The core of the organization is three committees made up of 13 members each. Thus, the heart of the Bilderberg Group consists of 39 total members of the Illuminati. The three committees are made up exclusively of members of all the different secret groups that make up the Illuminati, the Freemasons, the Vatican, and the Black Nobility. This committee works year-round in offices in Switzerland. It determines who is invited to the annual meeting and what policies and plans will be discussed. Every proposal or plan that has ever been discussed at an annual meeting of the Bilderberg Group has come to pass usually within 1 or 2 years following the meeting. The Bilderberg Group is directing the quiet war that is being waged against us. How can they do it? These are the men who really rule the world. Manly P. Hall, 33rd degree Mason, probably the most renowned expert on these subjects, wrote in his book, The Secret Destiny of America, for more than 3,000 years, secret societies have labored to create the background of knowledge necessary to the establishment of an enlightened democracy among the nations of the world. All have continued, and they still exist, as the order of the quest. Men bound by a secret oath to labor in the cause of world democracy decided that in the American colonies they would plan the roots of a new way of life. The Order of the Quest was set up in America before the middle of the 17th century. Franklin spoke for the Order of the Quest, and most of the men who worked with him in the early days of the American Republic were also members. Not only were many of the founders of the United States government Masons, but they received aid from a secret and august body existing in Europe, which helped them to establish this country for a particular purpose known only to the initiated few. The members of the Bilderberg Group are the most powerful financiers, industrialists, statesmen, and intellectuals who get together each year for a private conference on world affairs. The meetings provide an informal, off-the-record opportunity for international leaders to mingle and are notorious for the cloak of secrecy they are held under. The headquarters office is in The Hague in the Netherlands. The goal of the Bilderberg Group is a one-world, totalitarian socialist government and economic system. Take heed, as time is running short. You must understand that secrecy is wrong. The very fact that a meeting is secret tells me that something is going on that I would not approve. Do not ever believe that grown men meet on a regular basis just to put on fancy robes, hold candles, and glad-hand each other. George Bush, when he was initiated into the Skull and Bones, did not lie naked in a coffin with a ribbon tied around his genitalia and yell out the details of all his sexual experiences because it was fun. He had much to gain by accepting initiation into the order, as you can now see. These men meet for important reasons, and their meetings are secret because what goes on during the meetings would not be approved by the community. The very fact that something is secret means there is something to hide. John Robison wrote Proofs of a Conspiracy in 1798, and I believe he said it best in the following passage. Nothing is so dangerous as a mystic association, the object remaining a secret in the hands of the managers, the rest simply put a ring in their own noses by which they may be led about at pleasure. And still panting after the secret, they are the better pleased the less they see of their way. A mystical object enables the leader to shift his ground as he pleases and to accommodate himself to every current fashion or prejudice. This again gives him almost unlimited power, for he can make use of these prejudices to lead men by troops. He finds them already associated by their prejudices and waiting for a leader to concentrate their strength and set them in motion. And when once great bodies of men are set in motion, with a creature of their fancy for a guide, even the engineer himself cannot say, "Thus far shalt thou go, and no farther." Is the common man really as stupid as the elite seem to believe? If he is, then maybe the average citizen is better off ignorant, being manipulated this way and that whenever the elite deem it necessary. We will discover the answer very quickly when the common man finds that his e-ticket to Fantasyland has just expired. I hope I have shown you the role of secret societies and groups within the world power structure. I hope you can see how these groups gain and keep power. You should have some understanding of how operating in secrecy and infiltrating every level of government and vital industry, including the press, the elect manipulate the people and nations of the world toward any direction desired. I hope you caught on to the fact that the secret power structure is toward a totalitarian socialist state or fascism. It is not the Nazis, as they were a product of this power structure. It is not the Jews, although some very wealthy Jews are involved. It is not the communists, as they fit the same category as the Nazis. It is not the bankers, but they do play an important role. I also hope that you are beginning to look inside yourself to see if their reality fits. Are you getting the message? When our forefathers wrote the Constitution of these United States, they provided safeguards against despotism by providing a balance of power. The Constitution was set up to provide clear divisions of legislative, judicial, and executive powers. It was believed that this system would ensure that if one branch got out of hand, the other two would act to keep the one in check. This balance of power was predicated upon the assumption that none of the three branches could or would infringe upon the power of the others. The Constitution is clear on the functions of each of the branches. The legislative will make the laws. The judicial will interpret the law. The executive will decide policy and enforce the law. This, of course, is the simplest of explanations, but this is not a textbook on government. My intent is to acquaint you with simple basics of the balance of power so that you can then understand how it has been subverted. The legislature, made up of Congress in the form of the House and Senate, is required to publish the laws that are made, and this is done in the Congressional Record and the Federal Register. pending or past legislation can be obtained by citizens through their congressmen or from the government printing office. Citizens cannot be held responsible for the law if it is not made available to them. It is paradoxical that the government body most representative of the American citizen is the one that has been the most easily subverted. Through political action committees, payoffs, pork barrel politics, professional politicians, congressmen who are members of secret societies, and through greed and fear, our representatives and senators quit representing us long ago. Congress has tremendous power, but fails in most cases to exercise even a token amount. How is it that our legislature has allowed and at times encouraged the executive branch to write law? You probably did not know that the president and others in the executive branch of the government can and do write law. This is done in the form of presidential executive orders, National Security Council memos, National Security Decision directives, and National Security Directive. NSC memos were broad policy papers in the days after passage of the National Security Act. NSC memos became narrower and more specific over the years, and the name has varied. Under Kennedy, they were called National Security Action Memorandum. President Bush changed the name to National Security Directive. There is a tremendous difference between presidential executive orders, NSC memos, and National Security Decision Directive. Presidential executive orders are listed in the Federal Register, or presidential findings which are made known to the House and Senate Intelligence Committee. The most important difference between the presidential executive orders and all of the others, no matter what they are called, is that the others do not have to be reported, reviewed, made available to anyone, or even acknowledged that they exist. There is no oversight whatsoever that could maintain a check on the legality of these national security directives. The president and others within the executive branch have used these super secret directives to skirt the balance of power and write law without anyone's knowledge. Justification of the president's power to write law through executive orders stems from the failure of the government to rescind the declaration of martial law during the Civil War. In effect, the United States has been under martial law ever since Lincoln's administration. These NSDs are powerful, hidden, and dangerous tools. They were prolific during the Reagan administration. Over 300 were written, with no more than 50 ever leaking out to undergo public scrutiny. Yet, most Americans have never heard of these subversive weapons. They are being used to destroy our Constitution. I believe that everyone should know about this corruption of government. Congress has turned a blind eye to these abuses of executive power. At 3:30 a.m., Saturday, August 4, 1990, the Senate made it even easier for the executive branch to subvert the Constitution and may have made George Bush the first American king. At that time, on that day, a minority of United States senators, maybe 10 at the most, passed Senate Intelligence Authorization Act for fiscal year 1991. The bill was fraudulently introduced as a reform to prevent future incidents of the abuses brought to light during the Iran-Contra scandal. Instead of preventing future abuses, however, it virtually authorizes essentially every abuse. The bill was carefully brought to a vote by Senator Sam Nunn in the dead of night when the opposition was gone. It effectively transfers most authority over the United States government directly into the hands of the president and thus directly into the hands of the secret government. The president was given the power to initiate war, appropriate public funds, define foreign policy goals, and decide what is important to our national security. In Oversight of Intelligence Activities, Title 7, Senate Bill 2834 authorizes the following. Gives the president power to initiate covert actions. This has never before been given to the president. Prevents Congress from stopping the president's initiation of covert actions. allows the president to use any federal departments, agencies, or entities to operate or finance a covert operation, empowers the president to use any other nation or private contractor or person to fund or operate a covert action, redefines covert actions as operations necessary to support foreign policy objectives of the United States, a definition that is so vague and broad as to be essentially unlimited, for the first time officially claims the right of the United States to secretly interfere in the internal, political, economic, or military affairs of other countries in direct and flagrant violation of international law, requires that the president prepare and deliver a written finding to the intelligence committees of the Congress, but allows the president to omit extremely sensitive matters and authorizes the president to claim executive privilege if Congress asks too many questions. There are no penalties in the bill for violating any of its provisions, including the provision requiring a finding. Why should there be? This bill has literally handed the power of all the branches of government to the president on a silver platter. The bill effectively prevents any oversight by anyone and allows the executive branch to skirt the law and to escape accountability. This will be done using national security directives. Either National Security Decision Directive 138 or a subsequent NSD Directive on Terrorism authorized the training of 3 Lebanese units for preemptive strike. When problems arose, Director of Central Intelligence William Casey took that operation off the books and enlisted Saudi Arabian help in an attempt to assassinate the head of Hezbollah. A resulting car bombing killed about 80 in Beirut. Sheikh Fadlallah, the target, was unhurt. The United States military, along with civilian law enforcement teams, conducted joint anti-terrorist training across America. To allay public fears, the participants wore civilian clothing. NSD directives have become the de facto legislative vehicle of the national security state. It has become known through the research of Susan Fitzgerald, a research consultant at the Fund for Constitutional Government in Washington, who has collected declassified NSD directives, that many were released without the White House letterhead at the top of the page and without the president's signature at the bottom. This, she speculates, is to conceal the fact that the signatures on some of them would reveal that they had been made by Otto Penn, not by Ronald Reagan's own hand. That should give you a taste of what we are up against. Please understand that virtually all but a very few NSD directives still remain classified, and unless the public forces disclosure, their effect will probably never be known. Somewhere within the volumes of secret NSD directives, there is a plan to suspend the Constitution of the United States of America. The existence of this plan surfaced during the Iran-Contra hearing. Congressman Jack Brooks, Democrat from Texas, attempted to bring it into the open. When he asked Colonel Oliver North directly if North had ever helped draft a plan to suspend the Constitution, Brooks was silenced by the committee chairman, Senator Daniel K. Inouye, Democrat from Hawaii. Senator Inouye stated that the subject dealt with national security, and any questions regarding the matter could be brought up during a closed-door session. We never learned the outcome. I would like to know who gave anyone in any branch of government with any title the right to suspend the Constitution at any time for any reason under any condition. I believe the plan to suspend the Constitution is directly tied to the underground facility called Mount Weather and to the Federal Emergency Management Agency known as FEMA. Mount Weather is so shrouded in secrecy that 99.9% of Americans have never heard of it. FEMA, however, is another story. Remember Hurricane Hugo? Remember the federal agency FEMA that was sent to handle the emergency and was thrown out by the citizens because of gross incompetence? FEMA was incompetent, because emergency management is just a guise for its real purpose, which is to take over local, state, and federal government in case of a national emergency. The only way FEMA could do such a thing is if the Constitution were suspended and martial law were to be declared. Therefore, its very existence is proof positive that a plan to suspend the Constitution does, in fact, exist. Just outside of a sleepy little town called Bluemont, Virginia, about 46 miles west of Washington, D.C., is an area of wilderness covering what has been called the toughest granite rock in the eastern United States. The area is surrounded by signs marked Restricted Area, and this installation has been declared a restricted area. Unauthorized entry is prohibited. Other signs state, all persons and vehicles entering hereon are liable to search, photographing, making notes, drawings, maps, or graphic representations of this area or its activities is prohibited. Such material found in the possession of unauthorized persons will be confiscated. Internal Security Act of 1950. The installation is beneath a mountain, and its name is the Western Virginia Office of Controlled Conflict Operations. Its nickname is Mount Weather. It was ordered to be built by the Federal Civil Defense Administration, which is now the Federal Preparedness Agency. Mount Weather was designed in the early 50s as part of a civil defense program to house and protect the executive branch of the federal government. The official name was the Continuity of Government Program. Congress has repeatedly tried to discover the real purpose of Mount Weather, but so far has been unable to find out anything about this secret installation. Retired Air Force General Leslie W. Bray, director of the Federal Preparedness Agency, told the Senate Subcommittee on Constitutional Rights in September 1975, "I am not at liberty to describe precisely what is the role and the mission and the capability that we have at Mount Weather or at any other precise location." In June 1975, Senator John Tunney, Democrat from California, chairman of the Subcommittee on Constitutional Rights, charged that Mount Weather held dossiers on at least 100,000 Americans. He later alleged that the Mount Weather computers, described as the best in the world, can obtain millions of pieces of additional information on the personal lives of American citizens simply by tapping the data stored at any of the other 96 federal relocation centers. I know from my stint with the Office of Naval Intelligence that these dossiers consist of information collected about American patriots, men and women who are most likely to resist the destruction of our Constitution and the formation of the totalitarian police state under the New World Order. The Patriot Data Bank is constantly updated so that when the appointed hour arrives, all patriots can be rounded up with little, if any, effort. The plan calls for this to be accomplished in the dead of night on a national holiday. The most likely holiday is Thanksgiving, when everyone, no matter the religion, race, or creed, will be at home. The targets will be ripe for the picking after a heavy meal, maybe some alcoholic beverages, and during a deep sleep. There is a traitor in the Patriot movement who provides the secret government with accurate names and addresses of patriots who will fight to protect and defend the Constitution. My recommendation is that no patriot should ever be at home or in the home of any family member on any holiday ever again until the traitors have been hung and the Constitution restored as the supreme law of the land. Some sources state that Mount Weather is virtually an underground city, complete with dormitories, private apartments, streets, sidewalks, cafeterias, hospital, water purification systems, power plant, office building, a lake fed by fresh water from underground springs, a mass transit system, and many other astounding things. Several disturbing facts emerge when one researches Mount Weather. One is the conclusion that a complete parallel government exists at the site. 9 federal departments exist there. Agriculture, commerce, health, education, and welfare, housing and urban development, interior, labor, transportation, and the treasury. Apparently, at least 5 federal agencies are also in residence. Federal Communications Commission, Selective Service, Federal Power Commission, the Civil Service Commission, and the Veterans Administration. 2 privately owned corporations have offices at Mount Weather, the Federal Reserve and the United States Post Office. There is also an office of the presidency. What makes all this upsetting is that there is a president and a complete set of cabinet officers in residence at Mount Weather. Who are they? And who appointed them? Where is such a thing provided for in the Constitution of the United States of America? Mount Weather is the operational center, the hub of over 96 other underground federal relocation centers scattered across the United States. The majority of these appear to be concentrated in Pennsylvania, Virginia, West Virginia, Maryland, and North Carolina. Each of these facilities contains computer data banks holding information not on enemy agents, Soviet diplomats, or suspected terrorists, but on American citizens, patriots. A list of other files kept at the facilities was furnished to the Subcommittee on Constitutional Rights in 1975. The list included military installations, government facilities, communications, transportation, energy and power, agriculture, manufacturing, wholesale and retail services, manpower, financial, medical and educational institutions, sanitary facilities, population, housing, shelter, and stockpile. The committee concluded that these databases operate with few, if any, safeguards or guidelines. Senator James Aborczyk, Democrat from South Dakota, a member of the subcommittee, said, "I feel the entire operation has eluded the supervision of either Congress or the courts." Chairman Tunney said, "Mount Weather is out of control." Nothing was done by Congress to rectify the situation, however, and Mount Weather remains out of control. Former high-level officials from Mount Weather agree that the base at Mount Weather is much more than any standby government facility or storage center for the preservation of records. They describe it as an actual government in waiting. "We do not merely store essential information. The facility attempts to duplicate the vital functions of the executive branch of the administration. As stated previously, according to my research, this includes a president and all cabinet members actually in residence. Protocol even demands that subordinates address them as Mr. President or Mr. Secretary. Most of these mysterious appointees have held their positions through several administrations. We just act on the orders of the president in national emergencies," said one former Mount Weather official. The Federal Preparedness Administration, known as FPA, in its 1974 annual report stated that studies conducted at Mount Weather involved the control and management of domestic political unrest where there are material shortages, such as food riots, or in strike situations where the FPA determines that there are industrial disruptions and other domestic resource crises. The report states that the bureaucracy at Mount Weather invokes what it calls civil crises management. Officials who were at Mount Weather and who have furnished us with data say that during the 1960s, the complex was actually prepared to assume certain governmental powers at the time of the 1961 Cuban Missile Crisis and the assassination of President Kennedy in 1963. The source said that the installation used the tools of its civil crises management program on a standby basis during the 1967 and 1968 urban riots and during a number of national anti-war demonstrations against the administration by the American people. Daniel J. Cronin, who was the assistant director for the FPA, outlined a massive surveillance and manipulation program that is directed against the American population on a continuing basis. The FPA has organized an impressive armament of resources and equipment, Mr. Cronin described in an interview his agency's attitude toward its wide-ranging surveillance program. We try to monitor situations, he said, and get to them before they become emergencies. No expenses spared in the monitoring program. He cited reconnaissance satellites, local and state police intelligence reports, and law enforcement agencies of the federal government as examples of the resources available to the FPA for information gathering. The only document that I was able to find that attempts to outline some of the statutory authority of Mount Weather is Executive Order 11490. It was drafted by General George A. Lincoln, former director for the Office of Emergency Preparedness, which preceded the FPA, and was signed into law by President Nixon in October of 1969. Executive Order 11490 superseded Executive Order 11051, signed on October the 2nd, 1962, by President Kennedy. Kennedy's order used the language, whereas national preparedness must be achieved, as may be required to deal with increases in international tension with limited war or with general war, including attack upon the United States. Nixon's order began, whereas our national security is dependent upon our ability to assure continuity of government at every level in any national emergency type situation that might conceivably confront the nation. Nixon has deleted any reference to war, imminent attack, and general war from the order and replaced them with the phrase, during any emergency that might conceivably occur. Nixon's order, which is the one in effect today, allows the government in the form of FEMA to suspend the Constitution for literally any reason they decide to call a national emergency. I cannot find a plan or executive order anywhere which outlines any procedure or allowance for the restoration of the Constitution after a national emergency has ended. This leads to the obvious conclusion that no restoration of the Constitution is contemplated or desired by those in power. In 1975, Senator Tunney expressed concern when he said, "We know from what we've heard in the press that 15,000 names were being maintained by the Federal Bureau of Investigation for detention in an emergency. We also know that the Internal Revenue Service had its files on individual taxpayers. We know that the CIA had their Operation Chaos, and that the National Security Agency has the records of conversations that have been intercepted electronically. My question is this. Is there anyone, like yourself, General Bray, that is in control of the overall access to this data if it is maintained in a relocation site?" And your answer, as I understood it, is no. Then he continued, "General Bray, I must say that I still don't know who's in control of these relocation centers. You say you don't have that knowledge, and still we don't know from the three witnesses that we had here today that they had information as to who has control of those centers." "I am not at liberty," Bray answered, "to describe precisely what is the role and the mission and the capability that we have at Mount Weather or at any other precise location. I firmly believe that our continuity of government program has not provided continuity at all, but has been the instrument for discontinuing open and democratic government, and that the very program designed to protect Americans has actually been turned against us. There's a guy by the name of Buster Horton. He's a member of FEMA, and he's a member of the interdepartmental unit which is empowered in the event of a national security emergency to become the unelected national government, a sort of FEMA secret government, so to speak. A pretext for invoking those emergency measures can be found almost daily in the newspapers. It can be anything from the suspension of debt payments by the high bureaus of American countries to mass runs on United States commercial banks. And that's an issue, by the way, that was being handled personally by the National Security Council and Brent Scowcroft, to food shortages, to the drug war, the whole bit, anything, any disaster emergency declared at all, even including the oil spill from the Exxon tanker in Alaska. If the president had declared a national emergency, that could have triggered it. Any instability in the Middle East. Anything, in fact. And they've already tested their capabilities in April 1984 with Rex-84A. And that was designed to test the readiness of the United States civilian and military agencies to respond to serious national security crises. Now, the executive order that will implement this, the Executive Order 11051, details responsibilities to the Office of Emergency Planning, or FEMA. It gives authorization to put all executive orders into effect in times of national emergency declared by the President, increased international tension, or economical or financial crises. Note that it covers domestic crises but does not even mention war or nuclear attack. Now, the only thing that has to happen for FEMA to be able to implement all the executive orders, emergency executive orders, is for the president to declare a national emergency of any type, as long as it's a national emergency. Executive Order 10995 provides for the takeover of the communications media. Executive Order 10997 provides for the takeover of all electric, power, petroleum, gas, fuels, and minerals. Executive Order 10988 provides for the takeover of food resources and farms. Executive Order 10999 provides for the takeover of all modes of transportation, control of highways, seaports, and etc. Executive Order 11000 provides for mobilization of all civilians into work brigades under the government supervision. Executive Order 11001 provides for governmental takeover of all health, education, and welfare functions. Executive Order 11002 designates the Postmaster General to operate a national registration of all persons. Executive Order 11003 provides for the government to take over airports and aircraft. Executive Order 11004 provides for the Housing and Finance Authority to relocate communities, designate areas to be abandoned, and establish new locations for populations. Executive Order 11005 provides for the government to take over railroads, inland waterways, and public storage facilities. Now, all of these were combined under Nixon into one huge executive order, which allows all of this to take place if the president declares a national emergency and it can be implemented by the head of FEMA, not by the president. The president has already given him that power under these executive orders. All of these were combined into Executive Order 11490, and that was signed by President Carter on July 20, 1979, and is, in fact, law. Now, remember what North said during the Iran-Contra hearing. He said that they were prepared to suspend the Constitution of the United States, and he said if it hadn't been for their getting caught, that this would have happened. And all that did was delay. This is what is still going to happen. President Bush issued a new executive order delegating to the director of FEMA powers which were vested in the president by the Disaster Relief and Emergency Assistance Act of 1988. And although the order was described by the White House as simply a technical matter, in reality, the revision delegated to the FEMA director direct responsibility for a large number of items which were earlier only the president's prerogative. And that includes responsibility for general federal assistance, federal emergency assistance, hazard mitigation, individual and family grant programs, and the power to direct other federal agencies to assist in an emergency. And that's the key. All other federal agencies will come under FEMA. Of course, the president retains the power to actually declare an emergency. But as soon as he does that, the implementation of the measures utilized will be transferred directly to the director of FEMA. Professor Samuel P. Huntington drafted for Jimmy Carter Presidential Memorandum 32, which led to the creation of FEMA in 1979. He wrote the seminal piece for the Trilateral Commission in the mid-1970s, recommending that democracy and economic development be discarded as outdated ideas. He wrote as co-author of the book, Crises in Democracy. We have come to recognize that there are potential desirable limits to economic growth. There are also potentially desirable limits to the indefinite extension of political democracy. A government which lacks authority will have little ability short of cataclysmic crises to impose on its people the sacrifices which may be necessary. All of Huntington's ideas were rewritten into National Security Decision Directive 47, and that was enacted by President Reagan on July 22, 1982. It identified important areas to be upgraded, such as the nation's industrial base to maintain the national defense, but it nonetheless, and this is very important, laid the groundwork for the secret government's options to institute a police state, and its title is Emergency Mobilization Preparedness. It ordered preparedness measures that involved the waiving or modification of socioeconomic regulations that delay emergency responses and that should receive priority attention. It also specified that preparedness measures that are or may be impeded by legal constraints be identified in the priority task that lays the groundwork for the suspension of the Constitution. This has nothing to do with the right wing, left wing, or any other damn thing. It has to do with the Illuminati taking over this country and joining in the new world order. I give lectures all over the United States. At some point, before, during, or after every lecture, some well-meaning but misguided soul tells me that I have it all wrong, and that it's the Jews, the Catholics, the communists, or the bankers that are the cause of all our ill. The target group is blamed for everything that has ever gone wrong. Power over everyone and everything is always attributed to this group, whichever group it happens to be at that moment to that person. These poor people are on the right track in that there has been and certainly is a conspiracy to bring about a totalitarian world order. They are completely off track to think that any one ethnic, religious, or financial group alone could ever muster enough power to bring its plan to fruition. One group, you see, would always be opposed by all of the other special interest groups that exist and have always existed throughout history. That is, unless they were all really the same group, the Illuminati, or for some reason, they became unified, the Bilderberg group. The one group scenario, except for the Illuminati, has been used effectively to divert your attention away from the truth. It has caused you to fight each other in a manipulation that always leads the real conspiracy closer to its ultimate goal, a new world order. Following World War II, something happened that was to have tremendous significance for the future of all mankind. The intellectuals took note of this happening and brought it to the attention of the world power elite. The elite were severely shaken by the predicted repercussions of this event. They were told that by or shortly after the year 2000, the total collapse of civilization as we know it and the possible extinction of the human race could occur. It could occur, that is, if we did not destroy the Earth with nuclear weapons before then. They were told that the only things that could stop these predicted events would be severe cutbacks of the human population, the cessation or retardation of technological and economic growth, the elimination of meat in the human diet, strict control of future human reproduction, a total commitment to preserving the environment, colonization of space, and a paradigm shift in the evolutionary consciousness of man. Those in power immediately formed an alliance and set about bringing the recommended changes to fruition through propaganda, mind control, and other manipulations of the masses. The Illuminati's prayers had been answered. What was this event that caused so much consternation and changed forever the future of the world? Millions of soldiers returned from war. The soldiers found lonely, eager women waiting for them. The greatest coupling in the history of the human race occurred. The result was everyone born between 1941 and 1955 and the children that they would eventually produce. It was me and everyone who lives today. It was the great worldwide baby boom. It was the culmination of all men's efforts to survive through history. It was modern medicine, better diet, heat in winter, pure running water, and proper disposal of sewage. It was the point in history when the birth rate so exceeded the death rate that the world's population doubled between 1957 and 1990. It was the most wonderful time in the history of the world, but it was also the worst. It signaled the end of man's most precious achievement. An alliance of all of the powers on earth, open and hidden, decided that individual freedoms could no longer be tolerated in the interest of the preservation of the human race. They believed the common man could not be trusted. What had been the unfulfilled dream of many individual groups became reality by the concentration of power in the alliance known as the Bilderberg Group. What had been impossible before was now promised. The new world order that so many had envisioned was now a certainty. The first study was made during World War II to determine the impact of the returning soldiers upon the economy. The results mobilized the ruling elite. A second secret study was conducted in 1957 by scientists meeting in Huntsville, Alabama. It confirmed the results of the first. The conclusion was that civilization as we know it would collapse shortly after the year 2000 unless the population was seriously curtailed. Studies were done to determine a method to arrest the population explosion before the point of no return would be reached. It was determined that an immediate attack on the problem would involve two points of intervention. The first was to lower the birth rate, and the second was to increase the death rate. To lower the birth rate, several programs were put into motion. The first was the development of positive birth control methods using diaphragms and condoms, foam and birth control pills, and sterilization, abortion, and hysterectomy procedures. These were developed and implemented. The women's liberation movement was started with the demand for free abortion, using pro-choice as its rallying cry. Homosexuality was encouraged, and gay liberation was born. Homosexuals do not have children. Zero population growth became a hot subject at cocktail parties. Individual freedom, the heat of the moment, religion, and the old blue laws sabotaged these efforts, and while zero population growth became a reality in some areas, population increased rapidly in others. The only alternative left to the world's ruling elite was to increase the death rate. This was a difficult thing to do, as no one wanted to pick people out of a crowd and line them up for execution. Neither did they relish the possible consequences of an enraged public upon discovering that they were being systematically murdered. Of course, a very short but very deadly global war using nuclear weapons upon select population concentrations was contemplated, and to tell you the truth, was not ruled out. The fact that such a population control was even contemplated confirmed the worst fears of those who had participated in the 1957 study. War was put on the back burner to simmer, but may become a reality. In the meantime, something else had to be done that would absolve the decision makers of guilt and place the blame on those who did not lead clean lives. Something that could be blamed upon Mother Nature. What was needed was the bubonic plague or some other horrible but natural disease. The answer came from Rome. Several top secret recommendations were made by Dr. Aurelio Pacei of the Club of Rome. He advocated that a plague be introduced that would have the same effect as the famous Black Death of history. The chief recommendation was to develop a microbe which would attack the autoimmune system and thus render the development of a vaccine impossible. The orders were given to develop the microbe and to develop a prophylactic and a cure. The microbe would be used against the general population and would be introduced by vaccine. The prophylactic was to be used by the ruling elite. The cure will be administered to the survivors when it is decided that enough people have died. The cure will be announced as newly developed when in fact it has existed from the beginning. This plan is a part of Global 2000. Funding was obtained from the United States Congress under House Bill 15090, passed in 1969, where $10 million was given to the Department of Defense's 1970 budget. Testimony before the Senate committee revealed that they intended to produce a synthetic biological agent, an agent that does not naturally exist and for which no natural immunity could have been acquired. Within the next 5 to 10 years, it would probably be possible to make a new infective microorganism which could differ in certain important aspects from any known disease-causing organisms. Most important of these is that it might be refractory to the immunological and therapeutic processes upon which we depend to maintain our relative freedom from infectious disease. Sir Julian Huxley said, "Overpopulation is, in my opinion, the most serious threat to the whole future of our species." The project, called MK-Naomi, was carried out at Fort Detrick, Maryland. Since large populations were to be decimated, the ruling elite decided to target the undesirable elements of society. Specifically targeted were the Black, Hispanic, and homosexual population. The poor homosexuals were encouraged on the one hand and scheduled for extinction on the other. The African continent was infected via smallpox vaccine in 1977. The vaccine was administered by the World Health Organization. According to Dr. Robert Strecker, without a cure, the entire Black population of Africa will be dead within 15 years. Some countries are well beyond epidemic status. The United States population was infected in 1978 with the hepatitis B vaccine. Dr. Wolf Zmunis, the ex-roommate of Pope John Paul II, was the mastermind behind the November 78 to October 79 and March 80 to October 81 experimental hepatitis B vaccine trials conducted by the Centers for Disease Control in New York, San Francisco, and 4 other American cities. He loosed the plague of AIDS upon the American people. The gay population was infected. The ads for participants specifically asked for promiscuous homosexual male volunteers. Whatever causes AIDS was in the vaccine. The vaccine was manufactured and bottled in Phoenix, Arizona. Many other population controls have been promulgated. The reduction of the world's population to workable levels has been virtually assured. It is only a matter of time. The problem will be to curtail further human reproduction beyond approved levels. To handle that problem, the New World Order will adopt a communist Chinese model of population control. It is the only population control program that has ever worked. The old and infirm have been periodically murdered, and couples are forbidden to have more than one child. Penalties are so severe that families in China with 2 children are extremely rare. 3-children families are non-existent. A surprising byproduct is that Chinese children as a group are treated better than any other national grouping of children in the world, including the United States. Tobacco fields in the United States have been fertilized with the radioactive tailings from uranium mines, resulting in a tremendous increase in the incidence of lip, mouth, throat, and lung cancer. If you do not believe it, just look at the incidence of lung cancer per capita before 1950 and compare it to the lung cancer per capita at the present time. Are those who smoke committing suicide, or are they being murdered? We have watched the news in horror as story after story unfolded, revealing that the Army and the Central Intelligence Agency had released germs and viruses into the population to test their biological warfare capability. In light of what you have now learned, you should know that it was really to reduce population. It is a matter of public record that investigations into cover-ups of radioactive leaks into the atmosphere and into groundwater have revealed that some leaks were not accidental, but were purposeful. Some areas of the country now have such a high rate of cancer that virtually everyone who lives in these areas will die other than a natural death. The true extent of radioactive gases, waste, and toxic material, especially cesium-137, strontium-90, uranium mine and mill tailings, thorium-230, radium-226, and radon-222, that has leaked or has been purposefully planted in the atmosphere, soil, and groundwater is far beyond anything you or I can imagine. Every investigation has revealed that the true figures regarding radioactive leakage are much larger than official figures, and the real numbers may never be known. Cover-up has become standard operating procedure at all levels and in all departments of government. Do we dream reality, or is reality a dream? The New World Order will eliminate the population threat in several ways. Complete control of individual behavior may be established using electronic or chemical implants. No one will be allowed to have a child without permission. Stiff penalties wait for those who ignore the law. The violent, the old, the infirm, the handicapped, and the unproductive will be killed. Private property will be abolished. Since religion helped to create the population problem, it will not be tolerated except for the approved state-controlled religion, which will evolve according to man's need. Man cannot be trusted to safeguard what little is left in the way of natural resources. Technological development and economic growth will be severely cut back. Man will be required to live like his ancestors. Those who learn to be self-sufficient and can adapt to the absence of many of the things that we take for granted today, such as automobiles, will get along fine. Others will suffer terribly. Man will once again conform to the law of the survival of the fittest. No one is going to like the loss of individual freedoms guaranteed us by the Constitution and the Bill of Rights. I do not like or agree with what is planned. Intellectually, I know that people will not solve the problems that we face unless they are made to do it. That is a sad commentary on the common man, but nevertheless, it is true. The New World Order is evil, but very much needed if man is to survive long enough to plant his seed amongst the stars. A paradigm shift and star seed are the only legitimate long-term answer. This is why we have all been so wrong for so long. It never was what we thought it was. Nothing is or ever will be until we learn to live in reality instead of fantasy land. A paradigm shift in the evolutionary consciousness of man must take place. Right or wrong, the world is covered with agents of the Illuminati who are attempting to cause that evolutionary jump. We have not been taken into their confidence. It is true that without the population or the bomb problem, the elect would use some other excuse to bring about the New World Order. They have plans to bring about things like earthquakes, war, the Messiah, an extraterrestrial landing, and economic collapse. They might bring about all of these things just to make damn sure that it does work. They will do whatever is necessary to succeed. The Illuminati has all the bases covered, and you are going to have to be on your toes to make it through the coming year. We must learn to accept individual responsibility for the world's problems or be willing to live by the terms of those who do. We must learn to love one another, share, deplore violence, and work with nature, not against it. We must do all of this while colonizing the universe. Can you imagine what will happen if Los Angeles is hit with a 9.0 quake? New York City is destroyed by a terrorist-planted atomic bomb. World War III breaks out in the Middle East. The banks and the stock markets collapse. Food disappears from the markets. Some people disappear. The Messiah presents himself to the world. And all in a very short period of time. Can you imagine? The world power structure can and will, if necessary, make some or all of those things happen to bring about the New World Order. Patriots must not be at home on any national holiday during the day or night ever again until the danger is past. Disregard this warning, and you will find yourself in a concentration camp. In the camp, you will be treated for a mental illness called nationalism, common to patriots. This illness is not in the interest of the New World Order. Those who cannot be cured will be exterminated. When asked what was in store for the world in the coming years, Henry Kissinger said this, "Everything is going to be different. Many will suffer. A new world order will emerge. It will be a much better world for those who survive. In the long run, life will be better. The world we have wanted will be reality." A symposium was held in 1957, which was attended by some of the great scientific minds then living. They reached the conclusion that by or shortly after the year 2000, the planet would self-destruct due to increased population and man's exploitation of the environment without any help from God or the aliens. By secret executive order of President Eisenhower, the Jason scholars were ordered to study this scenario and make recommendations from their findings. The Jason Society confirmed the findings of the scientists and made three recommendations called Alternatives 1, 2, and 3. Alternative 1 was to use nuclear devices to blast holes in the stratosphere from which the heat and pollution could escape into space. They would then change the human cultures from that of exploitation into cultures of environmental protection. Of the three, this was decided to be the least likely to succeed due to the inherent nature of man and the additional damage the nuclear explosions would themselves create. The existence of a hole in the ozone layer may indicate that alternative one might have been attempted. This is, however, only conjecture. Alternative two was to build a vast network of underground cities and tunnels in which a select representation of all cultures and occupations could survive and carry on the human race. The rest of humanity would be left to fend for themselves on the surface of the planet. We know that these facilities have been built and are ready and waiting for the chosen few to be notified. Alternative 3 was to exploit the alien and conventional technology in order for a select few to leave the Earth and establish colonies in outer space. I am not able to either confirm or deny the existence of batch consignments of human slaves, which would be used for the manual labor as a part of the plan. The moon, codenamed Adam, was the object of primary interest, followed by the planet Mars, codenamed Eve. I am now in possession of official NASA photographs of one of the moon bases. I believe that the Mars colony is also a reality. As a delaying action, all three alternatives included birth control, sterilization, and the introduction of deadly microbes to control or slow the growth of the Earth's population. AIDS is only one result of these plans. It was decided by the elite that since the population must be reduced and controlled, it would be in the best interest of the human race to rid ourselves of the undesirable elements of our society. Specific targeted populations included blacks, Hispanics, and homosexuals. The joint United States and Soviet leadership dismissed Alternative 1, but ordered work to begin on Alternatives 2 and 3 virtually at the same time. In 1959, the RAND Corporation hosted a deep underground construction symposium. In the symposium report, machines are pictured and described which could bore a tunnel 45 feet in diameter at the rate of 5 feet per hour in 1959. It also displays pictures of huge tunnels and underground vaults containing what appeared to be complex facilities and possibly even cities. It appears that the previous 5 years of all-out underground construction had made significant progress by that time. For many years, the secret government has been importing drugs and selling them to the people, mainly the poor and minority. Social welfare programs were put into place to create a dependent, non-working element in our society. The government then began to remove these programs to force people into a criminal class that did not exist in the 50s and 60s. The government encouraged the manufacture and importation of military firearms for the criminals to use. This is intended to foster a feeling of insecurity, which would lead the American people to voluntarily disarm themselves by passing laws against firearms, using drugs and hypnosis on mental patients in a process called Orion. The CIA inculcated the desire in these people to open fire on schoolyards and thus inflame the anti-gun lobby. This plan is well underway and so far is working perfectly. A middle class is begging the government to do away with the Second Amendment. The media will convince the American people that a state of anarchy exists within the major cities. When public opinion has been won to this idea, they intend to state that a terrorist group armed with a nuclear weapon has entered the United States and that they plan to detonate this device in one of our cities. The government will then suspend the Constitution and declare martial law. A secret alien army of implanted humans and all dissidents, which translates into anyone they choose, will be rounded up and placed in the 1 mile square concentration camps which already exist. Are the people whom they intend to place in these concentration camps destined to make up the reported batch consignments of slave labor needed by the space colonies? The media, radio, TV, newspapers, and computer networks will be nationalized and seized. Anyone who resists will be taken or killed. This entire operation was rehearsed by the government and military in 1984 under the code name Rex 84 Alpha, and it went off without a hitch. When these events have transpired, the secret government takeover will be complete. Your freedom will never be returned, and you will live in slavery for the remainder of your life. You had better wake up, and you had better do it now. The conclusions are inescapable. 1. The secret power structure may believe that by our own ignorance or by divine decree, planet Earth will self-destruct sometime in the near future. These men sincerely believe that they are doing the right thing in their attempt to save the human race. It is terribly ironic that they have been forced to take as their partner an alien race which is itself engaged in a monumental struggle for survival. Many moral and legal compromises may have been made in this joint effort. These compromises were made in error and must be corrected. Those responsible should be brought to account for their action. I can understand the fear and urgency that must have been instrumental in the decision not to tell the public. Obviously, I disagree with that decision. Throughout history, small but powerful groups of men have consistently felt that they alone were capable of deciding the fates of millions. Throughout history, they have been wrong. This great nation owes its very existence to the principles of freedom and democracy. I believe with all my heart that the United States of America cannot and will not succeed in any effort that ignores those principles. Full disclosure to the public should be made, and we should proceed to save the human race together. Through ignorance or misplaced trust, we as a people have abdicated our role as the watchdog of our government. Our government was founded of the people, for the people, by the people. There was no mention or intent ever to abdicate our role and place our total trust in a handful of men who meet secretly to decide our fate. In fact, the structure of our government was designed to prevent that from ever happening. If we had done our jobs as citizens, we would never have reached this point. Most of us are completely ignorant as to even the most basic functions of our government. We have truly become a nation of sheep, and sheep are always eventually led to slaughter. It is time to stand up in the manner of our forefathers and walk like men. You must understand that, real or not, the purported presence of aliens have been used to neutralize certain widely different segments of the population. Don't worry. The benevolent space brothers will save you. It can also be used to fill the need for an extraterrestrial threat to justify the formation of a new world order. The aliens are eating us. The most important information that you need to determine your future actions is that this new world order calls for the destruction of the sovereignty of nations, including the United States. The New World Order cannot and will not allow our Constitution to continue to exist. The New World Order will be a totalitarian socialist system. We will be slaves shackled to a cashless system of economic control.
Now, here is an interview with author William Cooper.
So, Mr. Cooper, are there larger numbers of people all the time who are receptive to your message and who are thinking a little bit more deeply and critically about these fundamental issues of government and politics that perhaps they did not give as much thought to in the past?
Oh, yes. In fact, I never dreamed that I would make such an impact. When I first began what I'm doing now, which was many years ago, I was lucky if I could travel 1,000 miles and collect 3 people in somebody's living room, none of whom, by the way, would help me pay for expenses or anything else, to sit down and listen to what I had to say. And I did this many times, travel all the way across the country, just to talk to 2 or 3 or 4 people in somebody's home and put all the expenses myself. And now I can go to someplace like the Salt Dome in Salt Lake City and build a place up with people who want to come and hear what I have to say. And I think the radio broadcast has had a lot to do with it. My book has certainly been the number one underground book in the country for the last 8 or 9 years, and continues to be today. And I know that I'm really hitting the mark, and I'm really making people pay attention. When the President of the United States, William Jefferson Clinton, names me in a White House memo, which Rush Limbaugh read on the air, as being the most dangerous radio host in America. To me, that was the most tremendous compliment that I could ever receive. It was worth more than $50 million in my estimation. And if I don't ever do anything more than what I've accomplished, I certainly have accomplished quite a bit in the way of waking up the average American to stop believing everything that he's told or taught and start questioning and using his own mind for something other than to hold up the top of his head. And I think that's happening. I think people are beginning to question and think and arrive at their own conclusions today a lot more than they ever have in history. Trusting people is what got us in this situation. And the whole concept that imperfect man can rule other imperfect men and it's going to turn out all right is the most ludicrous proposition that I've ever heard in my life.
I think there are a number of people that agree with what you say who are aware of some of these facts. Again, the question to ask is, given that there may be ills and abuses on the part of the government today, what would be something that a person interested in seeing change could do? What sort of advice would you give somebody who wanted to have an effect for the better, who would want to influence events so that we would begin moving towards a change?
There are only 2 possible avenues of change at the present time. One is civil war, which we are heading toward right now. We're rushing toward a civil war in this country. And I foresee that is probably the most reasonable expectation that we can see happening. Not that I want it to happen. Not that a civil war is reasonable. But it's the reasonable conclusion after looking at the whole picture. The other is that we could somehow really educate the vast majority of what I call the American sheeple. These are people who are ignorant. Ignorant is not a bad word. It just means that they're without knowledge. If we could educate them and get them to understand that it is more important to stand up now and take a personal risk and educate other people and say that this has all got to stop, and be able to select our own candidates and make sure they get elected, no matter what the press or the television or anybody else tells us about them. Put them in office, people who will support, protect, and defend the Constitution, like the liars and the charlatans who are in office now swear to do when they take their oath of office, but don't. at all. Don't even attempt it, in fact. If you could get the people to do that, then there might be a possibility of a political, peaceful solution. But I can tell you right there, that's not going to happen. It's not going to happen in your wildest dreams, because most people spend the first 21 years of their life trying to get away from daddy and get away from home and become responsible and have their own responsibility in life. They spend the rest of their life, once they find out what that really means, in trying to find a daddy that will take care of them and take all the risk away from them and make sure that they have a job and that their diapers are changed and they have a bed to sleep in at night and a place to play and all of that kind of stuff, just like every other child in the world. And to stand up and be responsible and take a risk means that they're not going to find that. That's why socialism is so attractive to the vast majority of any people, not just Americans, but any people. It promises that they're going to have a daddy again who's going to take care of them. If they'll just give up all their rights and all their liberties, daddy will take care of them. And so that's what people are looking for. And you can see it in your daily life. That's the way they vote. That's what they want. They don't want to take personal responsibility. They don't want to take a risk. They're afraid of getting on a list. I've had people tell me to my face, Bill, I know all about this stuff, but I can't help you because I don't want to get on anybody's list.
Is it different anywhere else then, Bill? Because this question brings me to something I wanted to ask you anyway, and that is, in looking over other countries in the world, do you find any other countries with social or political models, even if it's only some aspect of their system, that you find worth emulating in other countries? Any other country or countries that you think go about the political process or the social contract, if you will, in a way superior to the United States?
No, I don't, as a matter of fact. Up until we began to take this left turn into socialism, the United States was the great light of the world, so to speak. We were the only free people who had ever existed in the entire history of humanity. We like to talk about our great heritage from England. The English were never free. They're not free today. They don't have freedom of speech. They don't have any of the freedoms that we've always had and cherished. In the history of the whole human race, the only people that have ever lived on this planet who have ever truly been free, the ultimate achievement of all humankind was to accept the individual as a king or queen in his or her own right, being responsible and having all of the freedom and liberties that they could possibly imagine right here in this country. And we created a government that was supposed to have a balance of power and was limited, strictly limited by the Constitution, and only given a very few powers in order to protect the freedom of the common man. That's all gone now. I mean, that's like a big, you hear these politicians in Washington today talking about how the Constitution is an outdated document penned over 200 years ago by a bunch of doddering old men who did not understand the complexities of the modern age. They won't tell you what you should already know, is that the document is not an outdated old document. It is a living constitution. It has within it the means for change should the people desire that it be changed. But the people don't desire that, so they just go ahead and throw it in the trash can anyway and go about their business doing anything that they want to do, while Joe Blow on the street doesn't even know that it's happening because he's never read the document that guarantees his freedom in his whole life.
So, Mr. Cooper, given the controversial nature of so many of the things that you have studied with regard to government and the law and the abuses thereof, tell us a little bit about how it has affected your personal life. You're a family man with two children. What kind of impact has the work you've done had on your family?
Well, that's quite an interesting question that doesn't get asked very much, but it's had a tremendous effect. If you want to find out how quickly society can turn against one, and I'm talking seriously here, stand up and tell the truth about just anything that you want to stand up and tell the truth about. It scares the living daylights out of everyone. And so the first thing that happens is you find out who your friends are and who your friends are not, because there's a great weeding out there. And it's not anything that you do on your part or that I've done on my part. They just disappear. And you find that very quickly that people are afraid to be around you because that they can see the government being upset about what you're talking about. And they can see repercussions coming. And of course, they have happened and will continue to happen. And ultimately, I really believe that there will be some kind of a terminal point where they decide that they're not just not going to put up with this pest anymore, and that's going to be the end of me. We have been literally financially in the ditch. We have found it impossible to get any kind of a normal job with anyone who knows anything about what I do. It's you can't go to church, you can't go to cocktail parties because everybody else is sitting around talking about the weather or, oh, what school did you go to? And when you have done the research and arrived at some of the answers that I know to be true now, those people become like kindergarten children. They're not in the real world. And I can't engage in that kind of a conversation. So you really find yourself in another world that has nothing to do with all of the rest of the people who are running around engaged in their activities that they think are so important to them. And to them, they really are. But to me, they've lost the reality of what really is important, and they're about to lose their freedom to even discover those things at this point.
I'll ask you a last question, and that is, how would you like to be seen or remembered in future years when people look back and you think about the thrust of your work? What is it that you would like to be best remembered for?
I think I would like to be remembered like Paul Revere was remembered, at a time when it was needed and nobody else would do it. I got on my horse and rode through the night and said, the British are coming. And this time it's not the British, although there's an element of the British here because England is a socialist country. I'm sure you know that. That's all. I'm not looking for any fame or any fortune. You certainly don't get rich doing what I'm doing. And infamous is probably the real word that describes what happens to you as far as public recognition. In a world where political correctness is the theme of the day, you just don't do what I'm doing. So if anybody wants to remember me, I would certainly be pleased if they just remembered I did what was the responsible and the right thing to do at a time when nobody else had the guts to do it.
Well, Cooper, thank you for your time.
You're welcome.